everyone. Thanks for attending my thesis event. I've been working with Professor Ray, Francesco and Ivan on this topic called Design and Implementation of a Virtual Networking Framework for the Mobility First Future Internet Architecture. I tried to explain the components of this title so that everyone sort of is on board. These will be the topics that I will cover. To introduce everything, so we have the internet, which was initially designed to connect devices to communicate with each other in the beginning, and it was based on IP, where every object in the internet connects to an access point and is provided a location-based address. So that's how it was designed, and the whole motivation for the internet was to just communicate, send messages from one fixed endpoint to another fixed endpoint. But of late, we've been seeing that the entire scenario is starting to switch towards more mobile communication. People are starting to use the internet for things like content retrieval. They're looking for information mainly. So a lot of research in the community is now is focusing on trying to come up with new internet architectures, future internet architectures, and to redesign the internet to cater to these new, to these differing requirements. So here at WinLab, we work with the Mobility First Future Internet Architecture, which focuses primarily on mobility and mobile communication. So the idea is to provide scalable mobility and wireless access. This is one of the topics in my title, and the other key word in my title was network virtualization, which is another buzzword in the industry these days, where virtualization basically means you have a physical resource and then you try to have logical abstraction in order to efficiently utilize that resource. So for example, when we deal with server utilization, we have it in the cloud computing scenario where you have a bunch of servers and you want to allow multiple users to use this server, or you want people to simultaneously use the server for their various purposes. So that's the idea of virtualization. And we've seen it most often in the context of server virtualization, and of late it's being ported to network virtualization in order to allow multiple networks to run on top of a given physical substrate. So I'll go into details of what the design details of mobility first and then network virtualization and how they both come together in our project. So yeah, like I said, mobility first is the future internet architecture, which is a clean slate approach to redesigning the internet, which we work on here at WinLab. And the reason for this this new design is to cater to the large number of wireless devices and the amount of traffic generated by them. Because we don't just use mobile phones anymore. We have mobile phones, we have laptops, we have wearables, we have the Google Glass, we have sensors, we have vehicles who want to communicate with each other, and the given IP-based architecture is not, we'll have too many fluctuations, too many disconnections, because of which we work with mobility first. And just like we have the IP's narrow waist design, we have our mobility first design where at the waist, narrow waist, we have, instead of the IP addressing scheme, we have something called the GUID, which is a globally unique identifier. So in mobility first, every object in the network is identified by a unique ID, which is the GUID. So if you want to communicate with any object, you talk to its GUID, and then the network takes care of figuring out where it's located and how to get to it. So that's mobility first. And this is like an overview. So our focus is mobile endpoints, and one of our key components is the GNRS, which is a distributed name resolution service, which takes care of these mappings between the GUID and the network addresses. So when I say all you need to do is communicate with the GUID and the network takes care of figuring out where it's located, it's the GNRS that's coming into play. And then we have our own routing protocol called the GSTAR, and then we have our equivalent of BGP, which deals with inter-domain routing, called the EIR. And we have with mobility first, because the naming scheme is based on these unique identifiers, we can provide various services called multicast, anycast, which I'll go into details as and when required. Like I mentioned, I'm just going to delve into a few details so it sort of gets etched in when we move forward with them. So like I said, GUIDs are these identifiers which identify every network object, and they are long-lasting network-level identifiers in the sense that no matter where the device moves, the GUID remains constant. So every time you want to refer to any object, and by object I mean it can be a mobile device, it could be a router, it could be a piece of content, it could be anything, any object in that network will be identified by the GUID. And the advantage is that since with this GUID, we not only refer to single objects, we can refer to group of objects. and based on context. If you want to say a group of objects in this particular location, you can identify them by a separate GUID. Or if I say a set of servers which provide a specific service, they can be identified by a specific GUID. So we have multicast groups or anycast groups based on these GUIDs. So that's one key point. And then with mobility first, one of the key design components was the fact that it supports seamless host and network mobility, in the sense that as the device would move, the device would not notice the fact that, you know, there is some, I mean, with IP, what happens is when the device moves, you'll keep changing your IP address. There's a lot of back and forth communication in order to maintain your connection. But with mobility first, all that back and forth communication is taken care of within the network. And so it's a very seamless mobility scenario for the endpoints. When I say hybrid name and address based routing, you can route to any object based on its GUID, as I said, but you can also route to it based on its network address. So you have both the options. You are aware of the GUID, and if you know the network address or where it's connected to, you can directly communicate with it to the network address. So when we say you can do a network address based forwarding, it's called a fast path forwarding, where you can just directly send the message. And when you have the GUID, it requires a resolution with the GNRS. So you query the GNRS to figure out where exactly it's located, and then you send the message. So that's the late binding service. And we have this name based network API, wherein we can support services such as multi-homing, multicast, anycast, like I mentioned. GSTAR is the underlying routing protocol for mobility first. So if you have a network which comes up with mobility first on it, GSTAR would be the routing protocol that we use. And it has a store and forward mechanism, in the sense that it's a, like at every router, it stores the message before it forwards it to the next hop. So this sort of helps in terms of when you have links with bad quality or you have fluctuations, you can take decisions such that you might want to wait for it to improve before you send a message out. So that's how GSTAR is designed for a mobile scenario. And hop by hop reliable transfer, as in, is different from TCP, wherein in TCP what you do is you make an end-to-end connection and then communicate your message. But with mobility first, we deal with hop by hop, so that at every router you wait for the whole chunk to be received before you forward it to the next one. So these were the design details of mobility first. And network virtualization is the other aspect of my project. So with network virtualization, the idea is, given a physical substrate, you want to bring up a logical network on top of that physical network. And the way this is done is you can partition the physical network to allow multiple networks to be formed, or what you can do is combine a bunch of physical resources to provide a slightly more virtual network with better bandwidth, or like aggregated resources. So the way we've seen it being implemented in the past are VLANs, VPNs, active and programmable networks, and overlay networks. So what we took away from, we sort of took inspiration from the first three in some sense. So with VLANs, we have the advantage of partitioning the physical resource to allow multiple virtual networks to run atop the physical substrate. In VPN, we see the encapsulation and tunneling mechanism, which we took inspiration for the way we do routing. And programmable networks, essentially, the idea is to be able to introduce custom routing algorithms. I mean, if you just bring up a regular physical network, it's always going to follow IP-based rules. So sometimes you want to introduce various other reasons, different methods of routing and things like that. So you want to have programmable networks, which was another aspect of research which we took inspiration from. And then there's overlay networks, which are similar to the test bed called Genie and Planet Lab, where you have it at the application there. But that's not what we considered. And the reason for network virtualization is the fact that you have a physical network, and when you bring up a logical network on top of it, you can specify any sort of topology. If I want a linear topology, I can say that, okay, I want a topology which looks like this, or you can have, basically, you can have flexible topology definition, that's one. And then when you have multiple virtual instances, you can have isolation among these, and that will be more evident in how when we discuss further, mobility first allows isolation in a very inherent manner. And again, this another advantage of virtualization in general is the fact that you can have multiple users simultaneously using a given resource, which holds even for a network virtualization scenario. And like we said, in programmable networks, we can introduce custom routing algorithms into this. And Yeah, so when we say we want to have a virtual network for mobility first, we try to identify the key components of mobility first which can be leveraged for our virtual network scenario. And one of the first thing was the GUID itself. So the fact that GUID can be used to identify any object in the network, it could be a piece of content, it could be a device. In our case, it could even be an entire virtual network by itself. So if I have multiple virtual networks running on top of a physical substrate, my way of identifying one virtual network from another is by its GUID alone, which makes it very simple. And then the GNRS is basically a data store of mappings. In our case, so we have the GUIDs mapped to a bunch of network addresses that the object might be connected to, or we can have a GUID to GUID based mapping. So I can have all sorts of mappings for my virtual network in this GNRS. So my virtual network, which is identified by a GUID, I can put against it in the GNRS the list of virtual router members in it. I can store the mappings between the virtual GUID of each member to its true GUID. So the GNRS is very useful in terms of maintaining these mappings and referring to these mappings as and when required. And slowly, the service anycast is probably the most important in our project right now, because that's what we use as a use case. So when we say anycast, what we mean is, given say we have a replicated service across three sites, each of these sites have their own GUID, but then we can also identify the service provided by these sites by a single GUID. So that would be like a service identifier for that particular service, which is actually located at three different locations. So if any endpoint, any client requests a service, it requests a service using that GUID, and the network tries to figure out which of these three cloud sites to route it to based on certain properties. So if I might define that I want to route it to one of these cloud sites based on certain algorithm, the anycast feature basically ensures that it goes to any one of these cloud sites as opposed to just the one that might be specified by. So anycast is basically given a service. Anycast is basically when you have a group of GUIDs which correspond to one service, for example. Using that service GUID alone, you can route to any one of these destinations. So that's one key thing that we try to use and demonstrate in our experiments. So we have the virtual network running on top of the physical substrate which runs mobility first, and what we wanted to show or demonstrate on this virtual network as a use case is something called application specific routing. And for this application specific routing, we keep in mind the service anycast feature that mobility first provides. So what application specific routing basically means is that given a certain say you have IP running on a network, every time you make a request, it always goes to the closest destination, and there's no other means of routing to any other destination right now, or any routing protocol for that matter. There's a fixed algorithm. But what we want to do with application-specific routing is to introduce certain metrics from the application layer, which can be combined in order to take a decision for whom the destination should be. So it's not the routing metric on layer 3 alone that we want to consider, but we want to combine the layer 3 metric as well as a metric specified by the application and then take better routing decisions. So for example, if you have multiple cloud sites, right now I would probably route to the one that's closest to me. But if I have application specific routing, I can specify the algorithm such that the application takes in, like, one of the metrics should be the utilization or how heavily loaded the servers are, as well as how far they are. So I could combine them to probably take a better decision to maybe route to a slightly less loaded server as opposed to something that's more heavily loaded and much closer to me. So maybe it will get clearer in a while. And the fact that mobility first service anycast is so easy to implement, that makes this choice of choosing an application specified server much easier. So this is an example where you have two cloud sites, and this is the client who's requesting a service which is replicated on these two cloud sites. So normally if not for these application specified metrics, it would always go to the cloud site which is closest to it based on, say, the time to reach the destination. But now what we want to do is to combine this metric along with that metric and then take a route which could be a better decision as opposed to just routing based on the shortest distance or the fastest distance. So in our ASR algorithm, we require to have newer metrics introduced and not just the routing metrics. So we define something called the application specified metric, or in this example would be edge performance metric, which reflects the the waiting time or the amount of CPU utilization or the how heavily loaded a cloud site is, and the link performance metric, which is a reflection of the link from router 1 to the cloud site, or router 1 to any other cloud site. So we try to combine both these factors to take different routing decisions. And we went over how combining these various metrics is not going to be an easy problem. So these are the two possible ways that we thought of. One would be just to have a numeric or an arithmetic combination of the two. So in the earlier scenario, we had the time taken to transfer a file from the client to one of the cloud sites and the waiting time. So in one of the examples we have, it's just a simple addition of the two. Or for our first version of the experiments, we use a threshold-based or a decision-space-based algorithm where we just have an if-else condition, wherein if the load at so-and-so place is less than a certain value, then choose based on the shortest routing or not. So these were just examples. And this is a high-level view of what our virtual network looks like. So the blue nodes are the physical substrate, and the yellow nodes are the logical or the virtual network running on top of this physical substrate. So if you have a route which goes from S to D3 and the virtual route is this way, the actual path that the packets would take to reach D3 would be via the blue route. So we'll have an example in a couple of slides. So this is just an overview, and these are the different components. We have a central coordinator which we've introduced in order to, which will be probably later, better designed later on, because right now it's still vague. But the idea of the central coordinator is to be that component which introduces to these virtual routers all the required details, like their what their GUIDs would be, what virtual network they're a part of, and things like that. So when we designed this, we had to introduce a lot more components. Like when there's a regular routing scheme, you have to have routing tables, you have to have control information and things like that. So for each virtual network, we have its own virtual forwarding table. So like you can see, the forwarding table for the G star will have its own metric, but now that we have application specific routing, the virtual forwarding table now has a different set of columns. So the new metric that we've introduced will be part of this virtual routing table, and the virtual routing table will help to take decisions on where to route the packet comes in. We have a different set of control information. So you have the physical substrate, G star runs its own routing algorithm, so it has its own link state packets. In the virtual network, we have the equivalent of that, and we call them the virtual network state packets, which are exchanged among the routers. And then because we have application specific routing, we need a metric that comes from the endpoint or from the application, and we call that application specific packet. So the virtual network state packets exchange the link performance information, and the application specific packets introduce the metric from the application. So additionally, now that we have a second layer on top of the physical layer, we need the headers, we need addressing to happen even in that layer. So what we used is, this is a regular packet for a mobility first packet, and we have the extension header space that's already provided. So we make use of that extension header space to introduce our virtual network information. So it's sort of like tunneling, wherein this portion of the message comes from the upper layers, this is the virtual network header, and then the virtual network header gets appended the routing header to push the packet from one hop to another, to physically push the packet from one hop to another. I'll go over an example for exactly how the encapsulation works and pushes the packet from the source to the destination. So if we consider the virtual paths to be from S to R1 and then R1 to D3, and the message that is to be sent has a destination BM D3, which specifies this one, and source is BMS. So we start off at S, and its routing tables look like this, where the ones on the right are the virtual routing table and the ones on the left are the actual routing tables. So if the intended destination is BM D3, and the next hop in the virtual network is BM R1. So it pushes it down to the routing layer, and the routing layer sees that if VMR1 is the intended destination for this packet, what is the next hop in the routing layer? It sees it's R1, it appends the header, and then pushes the packet to R1. When R1 receives it, it sees that it's a packet for itself, like the intended destination on the routing layer was itself, and then it pushes it up to the upper layer, which is the virtual layer, to resolve it, to figure out who the next hop in the virtual layer would now be. So here it says that VMD3 was the final destination for the virtual packet, and it says that the next hop is also VMD3. Now when it pushes down to R1, the path that it's going to take now is R1, R7, R4, R5, and then D3. So it looks up the routing table, sees that if the destination is D3, the next hop is R7, and so at each blue router it does a regular forwarding based on its regular layer G-star routing tables. And once it reaches R5, even though R5 is a virtual node, it sees that the destination is D3 and not itself, so it continues to forward it to D3 without having to resolve it to push it to the upper layer. So this is a simple example of how the encapsulation works, and this is what we implemented as part of our project. Coming to the implementation, the implementation was done in using Qlik Modular Software Router, which is a C++ based routing platform, and this is what the Mobility First prototype is written using. So the way Qlik works is you have modules, and each module, so every packet that comes in, it goes through a pipeline, and the pipeline consists of a bunch of modules which process the packet as it comes in. So it's very easy to put in your own modules, pull out and, you know, shuffle things around. So what we did was introduce a bunch of virtual processing elements. When it sees that a packet is meant for the virtual layer, it gets pushed into that branch of the pipeline, gets processed, and then comes out, and it gets pushed to the next element, to the next device. So we introduced our virtual processing elements, and the experiments that we conducted were on the Orbit test bed here at MindLab. So like I said, Qlik basically is a set of modular elements which you can put together, and it sort of forms a pipeline. So at the in queue, the packet comes in, it goes through a certain route. So here at the red boxes are where we made changes. The yellow is the virtual processing unit, and then the green, so these are the elements that we introduced. And the aggregator is the point at which we figure out that if this is, it's an element in the router, and if the packet is intended for the virtual processing unit, instead of going any other way, it would go into the virtual section, get processed there, and then get sent out accordingly. So, and in this region is where we look up, if it's a control message for the virtual network, we look up the virtual, we figure out how to broadcast it to its neighbors. If it's a data packet, we look up the virtual routing tables, which have also been implemented. We look up the virtual routing table and then figure out who the next hop should be. So these are the elements that we introduced. So we have an LSA handler for a regular, for the G-star routing protocol. Similarly, we have a virtual LSA handler which deals with the control messages that come in. Then we have a data forwarding section which takes care of how a packet should be forwarded based on the GUIDs as seen in the header. And these are the tables which we take help of. We have a neighbor table which keeps track of what the router's neighbors are, and the routing table which keeps track of, for a given destination, who the next hop should be, what the metric associated with it is. And we have the GUID map right now, which is sort of emulating the GNRS, because we haven't gotten around to integrating with the GNRS yet. That's one of the next steps. So this is, and right now the implementation supports a single layer of virtual network to run on top of it. For our evaluation techniques, we had two sections. One was to implement, it was a proof of validation using ASR, so I just came to it straight. So this was the topology that we brought up on Orbit. These are all the routers that we have, they're all running Mobility First, and then the yellow ones are the virtual routers. So the red links define the virtual network that we have. And 21 and 22 are the GYDs of these servers, and they have a replicated service running on them, and number one is the client who requests the service. So one requests a service with a specific GUID, and that GUID is, say, 1331. That 1331 corresponds to that service GUID which is running on 21 and 22. So 1331 maps to both 21 and 22, and along the way, every router will know that if this is the service GUID, I need to figure out which is the best path, or which would be the best destination to route it to, as opposed to defining that destination GUID as one of the servers. So this is the setup. What we used for our first version was that the link metric would be just the number of hops between the client and the server, and the node metric was a fake traffic generator at each server, and so that would give some sort of a utilization factor. So we could play with those numbers to alternate the loads at each of the servers. So these were our metrics, and the algorithm that we used was if between the two servers, if the minimum utilization was less than 0.5, if it was less than a certain threshold, you choose the one which is closer, and if both of them were higher than the threshold, also you choose the one that's closer. So this was the graph we got out, in the sense that this shows that the red and the blue lines are the utilization at each of these nodes. So we kept them alternating. So when one was highly utilized, the other one was free or relatively less, and vice versa. So 21, the blue one shows that for the first 10-15 seconds, 21 was lightly loaded while 22 was highly loaded. So that's how the load was alternating. And the numbers which within those dotted lines show which server was chosen as the one to be routed to, or which one actually received the request from the client. So if you see, even in the first one, the blue line has lower value and the red line is high. And since the blue one corresponds to 21, the server 21 was chosen because the algorithm was such that it was a symmetric experiment setup, so it would choose the one which was lesser loaded as opposed to anything. So we saw that this was a validation that the algorithm works and our routing is happening the right way and the way we expected it to. Then we wanted to evaluate the performance of this virtual network, so we have these micro benchmark experiments. This was the setup such that the first one is without the virtual network and the second one is with the virtual network. So we want to compare the performance of the virtual network with a regular mobility first topology. So the first experiment that we conducted was a ping experiment, which is just to check the round trip time between the ping. From the client to the server, how long does a ping packet or a ping message take to go and come back? And we see not much of a difference between the red and the yellow and the blue line. The blue line is a regular ping on a normal mobility first network, and the red one is over the virtual network. So it does perform a little bit worse, but not much more. So it's justified in the sense that we have virtual processing elements which might add a little bit of overhead in terms of processing time, but it's not enough to be worried about. And then we used another networking tool called IPER, which pushes data streams into the network and sees how much throughput is achieved on that network link. And we see that it's very, very close to the one with the virtual network is very close to the one without the virtual network, and this is mainly because we right now are utilizing the already existing extension header, so we're not really introducing much overhead into our network right now. So these were fairly good results, but we still have to look into other stuff. So yeah, in conclusion, this is what we've demonstrated, and the virtual network works. We have certain performance evaluation complete, but there's a lot more work in terms of there's a few things that we need to integrate, in the sense that Anusha is working with me on having a more realistic application at the server end. So we're trying to emulate a cloud service scenario. So we have right now the experiment or our validation uses number of hops and a fake traffic generated as our metrics, but now we would like to have the actual estimated transfer times from the routing layer, as well as a metric which is introduced from a cloud side. This is the first step. And then another thing that we want to improve on is the fact that right now we have a single virtual network layer which uses just this set of tables, but with a we want to have multiple virtual networks to be supported on this physical substrate, and we want to be able to show that with mobility first, it's easy to switch among these multiple virtual networks, and that isolation is indeed very well. I mean, is mobility first is suited for multiple virtual networks for easy isolation. So these would be the next steps, and we're working on it right now.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So.